I am Brother Stephen Elabo, welcoming you to Deeper Life Bible Church, Charlottesville, United States, a place where the undiluted Word of God is being preached. You are about to listen to our General Superintendent, Pastor W.F. Kumoye, as he comes forth to share the mind of God with you and your family. I want you to be ready. Pick up your pen and your paper and jot down important messages as they will do you good. God bless you and remain blessed.
For me tonight, we're looking at 1 Thessalonians chapter 2. And today we're considering one verse of scripture, very important, very essential. We've gone through already chapter 1, and we've gone through chapter 2. It's like we've come to the end of chapter 2. But we single out verse 18 because of its importance to the believer. And to every child of God, to the family of God, the whole church, and then even to the world, so that the world will see what hinders them from having what they ought to have, the time they ought to have it. We're looking at 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 18. Wherefore we would have come unto you, even I, Paul, once and again, but Satan hindered us. The verse of scripture tells us why Paul the apostle, together with his partners, preaching partners, Silas and Timothy, why they had not been able to get to Thessalonica again as they planned to do. The people of Thessalonica, if they didn't understand, many of them could complain, but thank God they didn't. Many of them could get into conflict, but thank God they didn't. And many of them could come into condemnation, the condemnation of the apostle, and the condemnation of the partners of the apostle, saying they've lost interest in us. They're not doing the way they used to do. We saw they'll come back again, but they're not here. But thank God that they didn't do any of that. And sometimes when things happen in the church, maybe in the headquarters church, or in the local church, in the regional church, or in the state church, that we need to understand that the whole thing is not in the hands of the leaders, of the leadership. There are times when Satan hinders. Look at that again. It says, wherefore we, that means Paul, Silas, Timothy, we would have come unto you. Even I, Paul in particular, would have come once and again, which means I would have come more than once. But Satan hindered, not just Paul the apostle alone, but Satan hindered the three of them. How did that happen? And what was he wanting to go and do once again when he said, would have come once and again? What was he to do? And when our regional overseers visit the local governments, why are they doing that? And when the state overseers visit the state, the local churches and the regions and everywhere, why are they doing that? And when any of our leaders and pastors, missionaries, when they visit all those local churches, what are they to do? And what was Paul thinking of going to do? Number one, he wanted to go and give them a second benefit. 2 Corinthians chapter 1. We're looking at verse 15. In days confidence I was minded to come unto you before, that ye might have a second benefit. There is a first benefit, conversion. There is a first benefit, salvation. There is a first benefit, turning to the Lord. There is a second benefit, that is sanctification. That is holiness. That's the strengthening of the church. That's the leading the church to the strength of the Lord. And Paul the apostle said, I'm coming. I want to come so that you would have a second benefit. And the reason I wanted to go to Thessalonica is so that they'll have that second benefit, salvation, they had God. Now they needed sanctification. Now they needed holiness. Now they needed to be standardized and to be steadfast in the faith. Number two, that he may impart unto them some spiritual gifts to the end they may be established. We're looking at Romans chapter 1. The reason why I wanted to go to them once and again, and the reason why Satan hindered him and hindered them, is so that they will not have this that Paul the apostle wanted to give unto them. Romans chapter 1 verse 11, for I long to see you, that I may impart unto you some spiritual gift to the end ye may be established. You know, when people are born again, when they come to know the Lord, but they're still doubting, they don't have assurance, is this real? And is it going to last forever? Or is it just for the moment? Then to establish them and to make them firm in the faith. And whenever we go to do follow-up, isn't that the reason why we go? To visit the people that are born again already, and to visit churches that are planted already, so that those churches, they'll have an impartation, impact upon their lives, and then they will be established. Number three is to establish them in the faith and to strengthen them so that they'll be able to resist this tempter. The tempter is not happy. Satan is not happy. The devils, demons are not happy that believers have come to know the Lord. They have given their lives to know the Lord Jesus Christ. And now their names are written in the book of life in heaven. And the devil wants to do whatever he can do so that it will tempt them. And it will trip them. And it will make them to fall. That's the reason why Paul the apostle wanted to go there. I want to remind our region of ourselves again, our state of ourselves again, our missionaries again, our pastors again, our group coordinators again. When we go around, we're not just there to entertain the people. When we go around, we're not just to go there and make, how are you there? We're to go there and establish them. We're to go there and establish the second benefit, sanctification, holiness in their lives, in their hearts, in the church. We're to go there and make sure that whatever temptations they're facing, we'll show them how to resist the temptation and how to stand firm in the righteousness and the holiness of the Lord. In 1 Thessalonians chapter 3, I'm reading there from verse 1. 1 Thessalonians chapter 3, verse 1. Wherefore, when we could no longer forbear, we sought it good to be left at Athens alone, and sent Timotheus, our brother and minister of God, and our fellow laborer in the gospel of Christ, to establish you, to comfort you concerning your faith, that no man should be moved by these afflictions. For yourselves know that ye were appointed, and we were appointed thereunto. The reason why all the apostles with his team, why they wanted to visit Thessalonica again, is so that they'll be able to strengthen them, establish them in the faith, so that the temptation coming to them will not make them to fall. Number four, it was to perfect that which was lacking in their faith. Faith is the reason why we get saved. Faith in Christ. We get saved by faith, by grace through faith. And then we walk by faith. And every blessing we get by faith. And whatever was lacking in their faith, Paul the apostle wanted to reach out to them so that it will strengthen their faith and perfect their faith. 1 Thessalonians chapter 3, we're looking at verse 10. It says, night and day, praying exceedingly, that we might see your face. That's why I wanted to come. To come once and again, so that we can see your face. And in that verse 10, and that we might perfect that which is lacking in your faith. Are you not learning something as a believer? You've done the evangelism. Some people have come to know the Lord. Temptation will come to them. Go back to them. Strengthen them. And make them understand that temptations do come. Trials do come. Troubles do come. But we can stand in the Lord and be firm in the Lord and remain in the salvation it has given us. And also when they face some problems and some challenges and they're wondering whether their faith will carry them through or not, you're there to strengthen their faith and to perfect that which is lacking in their faith. Number five, it was to establish their hearts unblameable in holiness before God. We're looking at verse 13 of that same chapter 3. To the end, he may establish your hearts unblameable in holiness before God, even our Father, at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ with all his saints. If there's anything the new convert is ignorant of, is ignorant of righteousness. If there's anything in new church is ignorant of, they're ignorant of holiness. And so we who have preached the gospel to them, and we who have followed them up, or who are following them up, want to be able to reassure them that the reason we became Christians is that we become new creatures in Christ. And if any man be in Christ, is what? Tell me out loud. is a new creature. Old things are passed away. We need to go and reconfirm with those believers. The old habits are gone, and the old character is gone, and the old dispensation, everything is gone. Something is new now, a new life of righteousness, a new life of holiness that they are to live, and that there will be above reproach, above blame, above spot. It says so that we can establish our hearts unblameable in holiness before God. You see the people of the world before they became born again, those who are born again now, they were living their lives just to please men. Everything they did is, how do people see this? How do people appreciate this? How do people commend me, applaud me for this? And now when they become Christians, Paul the apostle wanted them to know that your mind is on God. Your focus is on God. Your appreciation is coming from God. Your commendation is coming from God. He wanted them to know that now the holiness they were to live in was the holiness before God. Even our Father. Yes, so light will shine before men. Your preoccupation is not for man anyway. It is for God. That's what you wanted to go there and do, so that they will be established in holiness. Number six, what will reassure them concerning their brethren who had died before the rapture? Some of those people in Thessalonica, they began to wonder. Now you're talking about the rapture. You're saying that Christ is coming again. And then those of us who are alive will be caught up together with them. What happens to our brethren who have died? What's going to be their lot and their portion? That's the reason Paul, the apostle, wanted to go back to them so that he can reassure their hearts, so that he can reaffirm their faith, so that he'll tell them that those who have died, they have not lost anything and we have not lost them. Chapter 4, I'm reading from verse 13. Chapter 4, verse 13. But I would not have you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning them which are asleep, that ye sorrow not, even as others which have no hope, because they were ignorant of that. They were sorrowful, they were sad. Somebody had died, some people had died. What's going to be their lot? What's going to be their portion? How about the rapture that is going to take place? For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so, them also which sleep in Jesus will God bring with him. For this we say unto you by the word of the Lord, that we which are alive shall remain unto the coming of the Lord shall not precede or prevent them, hinder them that which are asleep. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. He said, let your heart be comforted. In fact, those who are dead in Christ, before we are changed, and before we are caught up, and before we are raptured, they will rise up, and then all of us eventually will be together with the Lord. Look at verse 17. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so shall we ever be with the Lord. I wanted to come and tell you that and comfort you now that I'm not there. You do that yourself and comfort one another with these words. Number seven, it was to prepare them for the coming day of the Lord, because that day will come as a thief in the night, and because it will come suddenly and yet come surely. Paul the apostle wanted to come to these people once and again so that he can reassure them the Lord is coming, and the day of the Lord for the believer will be a day of light, and then for the unbeliever will be a day of darkness. For the believer, a day of joy. For the backslider, a day of sorrow and a day of gloom and a day of darkness. And he wanted to come and remind them that because of that coming day, coming suddenly and coming early, that they had to prepare themselves. Chapter 5, I'm reading from verse 1. In chapter 5, verse 1, it says, but of the times and the seasons, brethren, ye have no need that I write unto you, for yourselves know perfectly that the day of the Lord so cometh as a thief in the night. For when they shall say, peace and safety, then sudden destruction cometh upon them, as travail upon a woman with child, and they shall not escape. Then he said, you know, it's been using, they'll come upon them as a thief in the night, and they shall not escape. How about us? How about the believer? Can you give us any assurance what will happen to us? Look at verse 4. But ye, brethren, are not in darkness, that day should come, should overtake you as a thief. Ye are all children of light, and the children of the day. We are not of the night nor darkness. Therefore, let us not sleep as do others, but let us watch and be sober. He wants us to be ready. Let's come back to 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 18. 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 18. Wherefore, we would have come unto you, even I, Paul, once and again. Now, you know the reason why he wanted to go there, why he wanted to see them, why he wanted to visit them again, so that they'll be able to stand unshaken, having conviction and having a kind of steadiness in the Lord. That's why I wanted to go. But then, why did he not go? Why was he not there? Look at verse 18, the latter part. But Satan hindered us. That's a big question you're asking yourself, you're asking me, you're asking everybody, if you can find opportunity. Why will Satan hinder them? And what does Satan hinder? When you're working for Satan, he doesn't hinder you. When you're laboring for the devil, he doesn't hinder you. When you are laboring for something temporary, it doesn't hinder you. When you're laboring for something worthless, useless, of no account, of no benefit to the kingdom of God, it doesn't hinder you. Do you remember that Paul the Apostle had been a religious man? And all the days and all the years, he had been in religion. In fact, he said, I profited above many my equals in religion. Satan never bothered him. Satan never hindered him. But why is Satan hindering at this time? He hinders righteousness. It doesn't hinder religion. It hinders righteousness. It doesn't hinder the people that are superficial in the religion and people that are just, you know, here and there, very active and going up and down. Satan doesn't mind that. What he wants to hinder is the salvation of souls. The people who are getting saved, the people who are getting to know the Lord, when Satan sees that something is going on, and it is not just something that is just religious, but it's producing salvation of souls, and it's producing sanctification, holiness, purity of heart, and it's getting people ready for heaven, that's what Satan hinders. And when Satan sees that holiness is being emphasized, and holiness is getting to the hearts of the people and getting to the lives of the people, and they're having the Christian character, the Christian conduct, and they're having Christ-likeness in their lives, and their lives have been changed and turned around, carnality going, immorality going, evil going, and they're turning away from idols, and they're turning unto the living God, then that is what Satan hinders. That is the same why you'll find that the real apostles of the Lord and the real teachers of the gospel and the real preachers of the gospel and those who are real evangelists and they're turning people to Christ, people are getting saved and people are getting sanctified, holiness of heart and purity is being passed unto them. That's what Satan wants to hinder. And you look at your life, maybe you're making fun of people like Paul. Paul, what's the matter with you? Satan hindering you. Everything I do, Satan doesn't even get involved. I just go everywhere I want and there's no hindrance. Check out what you're doing. Is that just religion? Is that just social service? Is that just sacrifice, religious sacrifice? Is that just depending or maybe developing a denomination? Satan doesn't bother about that. What he bothers about is righteousness. What he worries about is salvation of souls. What he worries about is